The following interview is with Mr. Maximilian Kowler at his home in Lenox, Massachusetts on July 26, 1984. The interviewer is Sidney Bolkowski. Can you tell me your name and where you're from, please?
Max Kowler, Vienna, Austria, born in 1922.
And can you remember what the circumstances were under which you left Vienna? And then what happened after that?
We left Vienna pretty early after the Anschluss. We left in July 1938. We were fortunate enough to have a passport. We spent the last few years before the Anschluss, always our vacation, summer vacations in Hungary. So we had a valid passport when the Germans invaded Austria. All we needed then was a stamp by the German Besatzungsmacht, if we call it, or whatever we called it at that time. Anyhow, we needed a stamp, which we got very fast. I would say that Germany at that time hasn't realized yet how to prevent the people from leaving, or under what condition they should be leaving, or any of that. So we just had the passport. We had the passport stamped, Austrian passport, with the eagle and the swastika, and we just left, making believe we are going on vacation. We took the plane from Vienna to Venice. My father and I, we carried a tennis racket, small suitcase, and a camera, making believe we're going on a vacation, and that was it. No visa necessary to go to Italy. My mother stayed behind trying to sell the business, parts of the business, or furniture, or instruments. My father was a dentist. And within a few weeks, naturally, the German discovered that this loophole, sort of, had to be closed. And my mother got stuck then, and she had to buy her way out in buying a compartment on a wagon lit. And the compartment was not checked when it crossed the border between Austria and Italy, because the controller of that particular car and the border guards were paid off. That was arranged by a travel agency in Vienna, Reisebüro Schenker. And in Treviso at the border, that compartment was just ignored. And that's how she came then to Italy afterwards, about a month later.
Do you have brothers or sisters?
No.
So there were only three of you?
No, just the three of us, yeah. And Italy at that time was still relatively friendly to us, so we had a friend of my father's who lived there all his life. And he was the one who received us, who took us in then and helped us. We stayed there for a while and then naturally to get organized, sort of, and then realized that we better get going because Mussolini then started to collaborate more and more with Hitler, listening more and more to Hitler. So we just crossed the border then under what is called the Moyenne Corniche near Menton, Ventimiglia, from Italy to France. Illegally, we didn't have any papers or anything. Again, without anything in our hand, we just walked over the Moyenne Corniche, hiding behind a bus who was stopped at the custom controls, went over the bridge and walked into France, walked down to Menton, took a bus in Menton, public transportation, to go to Nice, and in Nice went straight to the synagogue. It was Erev Rosh Hashanah, I remember exactly. Went there, and they put us up then in a sort of, in a hotel which was sort of like a bordello, and was the safest place because it wasn't controlled by the police. And the next morning then somebody from the consistoire, from the Jewish, from the temple or Jewish agency or whatever it was, it wasn't the Agence Juive, you know, it was like a community center, Jewish community center, and they took us then to the police and they gave us residence as refugees, because France accepted illegal refugees at that time for political or religious reasons. And that's how we then stayed a few days in Nice, and from then on went on to Lyon, where we finally stopped then and sort of established ourselves.
As French citizens?
No, not French citizens. At that time, the nationality we had in France was called ex-Autrichien, ex-Austrians, okay? Eventually, later on, we got a passport, which was also a passport for sans nationalité. Exotician, it's a passport which is like a harmonica, I still have it, matter of fact. And we got working privileges, and France was very, very nice to us.
Well, look, just for a minute, were there any other members of your family, aunts, uncles, grandparents or cousins that you left in Vienna?
We left only a grandmother, my mother's mother in Vienna, who then was deported to Theresienstadt and never came back. The rest of our family, everybody left before us, if I remember correctly. Yes, they all left before us. No, not all. They left, some before, some after us, but they all left in a legal, in a legal way. But my mother's brother, my mother's brother was caught in Vienna before anybody else because he was a big clothing manufacturer, and the rich and important people, industrial people, the German National Gestapo came to look immediately, and he was arrested, and he was in the Hotel Metropole in Vienna, which was the famous hotel of the Gestapo. It doesn't exist anymore. It was bombed under, near the Schwedenplatz. And my father was very instrumental, matter of fact, of getting him out of there, because a cousin, if I remember correctly, a cousin of my father's was a lawyer, and one of his apprentices was a relation of Hitler, young man, and through him we got my uncle out, cost a lot of money naturally. We got him out and they put him on a boat, on a small boat, and crossed him the Mach River, which is the border with Czechoslovakia. Sent him into Czechoslovakia, and from Prague he flew to London. At that time there were still flights from Prague to London without landing in Germany. They overflew Germany. Everybody else got out either to Mexico, some to England. Everybody got out but my grandmother, who was too old really to emigrate somewhere, you know, and so she got caught and then died in Theresienstadt.
Back to Lyon, you were established.
Yeah, we came to Lyon then, and my father found work almost immediately as a dentist. Mechanicien dentist, which is a technician. And once his boss got to know him better and realized that my father knew more than he did, even as a surgeon dentist, as a doctor, you know, medical dentist, he even let him work in praxis as on the patients directly, you know. And France was very lenient about that. Again, they didn't make a big fuss. And, I mean, it wasn't official, but on the other hand, almost everybody knew, so he was pretty happy, naturally, being that he worked in his profession. I went to school, got immediately involved in the youth movements, and I had been a Boy Scout for many years before I came to France, immediately joined the French Boy Scouts, made friends, if one can say, assimilated pretty fast. I was 15 when I came to France, so naturally learning the language was no problem. I had 2 years or 3 years of French in Vienna. Not the slightest accent in French, believe it or not unlike in English, which naturally helped me later on during the occupation and during the part of Vichy France. It was a struggling, it was a hard life, struggling life. Naturally, we had a small apartment. My mother, to make a little extra money, I just remembered now, opened a little pension, restaurant in our apartment. She cooked cuisine viennoise, you know, and many of the refugees, inexpensive, you know, many of the refugees came to eat at our house, and they paid our food. I was a waiter there, my father helped them too. So we were struggling, but we did all right. It was human, it was all right.
Were you living among mostly Jews or among mostly emigres?
Yes, it was a like a colony. Yes, we were mostly between the refugees. Not myself, my parents. Yes, myself. No, because I joined the Boy Scouts already, and I was absolutely completely involved in the youth movements, and that was 99% French. French Boy Scout system is unique because it has four different. There are four different movements in the Boy Scout system. There is the one interconfessional, which is all religions, and then there is, that's the one I joined originally, and then there is one Jewish, one Protestant, and one Catholic. And they're all official Boy Scouts, you know, sanctioned by the International Boy Scout Movement. So I joined the interconfessional ones, which was basically French, and there were a few Jewish boys in there, but it was 90-95% French.
Then you had a number of non-Jewish friends?
A lot of non-Jewish friends, yes. More non-Jewish than Jewish at the beginning. Later on, during the war, then later on in years, then after the war, then I left that movement and I joined the Jewish Boy Scouts. And then naturally, then I had many more, most of my friends then were Jewish, and the others, then a part of them were non-Jewish because I still worked under general conditions on in the youth movements.
Before the war began, among the French, did you experience any kind of anti-Semitism?
No, not at all. The only thing we did experience sometimes, the only bad word I remember was sale étranger, dirty foreigner, if there was a curse. Anti-Semitism, absolutely. Absolutely none whatsoever.
Parents
any
either.
Time before the war.
Parents either, so I assume.
Same thing, yeah. No, nothing at all. No. If it was, I didn't hear it, I didn't see it.
Do you remember where you were when the war began?
When the war began, I just came back from a Boy Scout camp, matter of fact. My father was called, and being that he was a dentist, within a few weeks, he was put in sort of like a camp because the French government didn't know first what to do with us. Should they consider us enemies or should they consider us a danger to the government or to the nation, or should they worry that they are spies and what they call la cinquième colonne, whether we are part of the fifth column or whatever. So it took him a while really to make up their mind, and eventually my father was sent by the French army to the Royal Air Force to Le Mans, where he worked at the airfield in Le Mans as a dentist for the Royal Air Force. Now, I was too young, I'm born 22, so in 1939 I was considered 17, but on January 1st, 1940, I became 18 for all practical purposes. And then I signed up for the Foreign Legion because I felt I wanted to get out of Europe. It was not a question of adventure or anything like that. I just felt that's the best way to get out of Europe because there was no doubt in my mind. In February, or end of January, beginning February 1940, there was no doubt in my mind that the war will be lost because the French government didn't do anything. So I signed up in the Foreign Legion and then gave him my true age, got into trouble because of that, because my mother had to countersign my application, and then they found that the paper there and said I needed a second signature by my father. My father wasn't around, he was in Le Mans. So my mother got cold feet and tried to talk me out of it. Why would you go to Africa, etc., etc. So she finally talked me out of it, and they left me behind the night I was supposed to be shipped out to Sidi Bel Abbès. And there I was then. That was at the Camp Saturnin in Lyon, which was the departure camp for the Foreign Legion. And I then wanted to do something because we all wanted to fight Germans, and we all wanted to be on the side of the French people, defend France and defend civilization or whatever you call it. And so I signed up for the French army. That was, if I'm correct, on February 6th, 1940, and was sent to the Fort La Motte in Lyon. Still exists. I visited a couple of years ago. And for on the first or second day for recreation, actually, what do we do in Europe for recreation? We play football, soccer. And they found out I was a semi-professional soccer player before I was called into the army with a French industrial team in Bron, where the airport used to be. And they found out I was a very good soccer player, so they immediately put me on the army soccer team of that particular region. And so I played soccer for about 3 months. They left me at the Fort La Motte in Lyon. I did not see a rifle or anything. You know, and interestingly enough, in the French army, your food, you had different mess halls for the enlisted men, sous-officier and officier. And depending on what you wear, you got one more dish, for example, for your meal, or two more dishes for the meal if you're an officier. And the wine, I remember distinctly, the wine was different too. The French wine, when you buy Le Pinard in France, you buy them by degree, 10 degrees, 11 degrees, 12 degrees, you buy them in the open bottle, you know. So we got better food than the enlisted men, even so we were only enlisted men, because they wanted us to play better soccer. It was very funny. And they finally, when it became a little too dangerous up north, they finally remembered that there is a war going on, you know. In France, we used to call this at that time the La Drôle de Guerre. So they sent me then up to Angoulême. And in Angoulême, I was put into a company of tirailleurs Senegalais. And I worked with them for a while, horse and buggy, and transport. And then one day, the captain of my company called me to his office and said, you know, the German broke through the Vallée de la Loire and it's becoming rather dangerous here for you, especially because being that I'm Jewish, you're Jewish, and on top of it, they knew that as an ex-Austrian, I had signed a paper that I, to get the passport, the exit visa from Austria, then get stamped, that we swear that we'll never serve in a foreign army. So it became rather dangerous, and he gave me some civilian clothes and some money and said, get lost, in so many words, which I did. And I went from Angoulême down to Limoges, from Limoges to, I went through Vichy, before Vichy became Vichy, and through Vichy and went then to Tarare, which is a suburb of Lyon, where I stopped, because the Germans were still in Lyon. And Lyon was occupied by the Germans, and it was known at that time that Lyon will become part of France Libre, Vichy France. And I think the date was set within 3 or 4 days the German will get out of Lyon, but I was in a hurry to get into Lyon for personal reasons. And I went in there, smuggled my way into Lyon on a bus with school children who were evacuated from Lyon during the war, during the occupation, and during the danger of bombardments. I was lying on the bottom with the luggage, and the children were brought back even before the Germans left, because the French government knew already that the Germans are going to get out, and there's no more danger. The war was over. That part of the war in 1940 was over, so they brought the children back. So I was lying on the bus driver to let me lie on the bottom of the bus to get into Lyon to the checkpoint. And then went home. My father wasn't home yet at that time. He was still up north. And my mother was Lyon. She had never left Lyon. And I just knocked on the door. My mother almost passed away because she said, you're out of your mind. You're coming back into Lyon. The Germans are still here. They were not looking for me, but there was still a danger because the Germans were there. So I just hid for 3 or 4 days. I forgot exactly. I think it was 4 days in Lyon, in our apartment. And once the Germans left, that was it. And then we lived in what was called in Vichy France till really the situation got worse in 1942.
You said the French did not, you knew the French were going to lose the war.
Yeah.
The government didn't do very much. Was there any, among French Jews or among the emigres, is there any bitterness or resentment toward the French military or the French government?
No.
You think that they did what they could?
Yes, there should have been, there could have been. I don't think there was any. We just saw how incapable the French people were to fight the war, and they were not willing to fight the war. Our friends just sat there behind the Lin Maginot and thought the Lin Maginot is going to do the job. That the guns couldn't be turned around and the Lin Maginot was taken in by the back, you know, and all that. I mean, they were so, how should I say, completely unvoid. I don't know what the English word, I mean, they just couldn't care less. It was absolutely amazing. A lot of people say this because of the fifth, la cinquième colonne, and there are many reasons. I would just say France wasn't prepared for the war, and France didn't, the basic Frenchmen didn't want to fight the war.
Did life change drastically after the Vichy government?
You mean 1940?
In 1940.
Or in 1940? Yes, it changed because we, of all people, naturally started to worry because we had escaped Germany or Austria before, and we knew what could happen to us and what eventually would happen to us. So naturally, the life for us changed drastically because we were worried and we had to think of our future. Some of us never wanted to leave France when we came to France. Some of us used France only as a stepping stone to go further on, you know. But we were worried now to be caught there if we don't get out in time. The French people, I don't think they were there very much. The ones who were more, should I say, more intelligent, more sophisticated, or I don't know, maybe they began to worry and said, all right, we are living now under a government which, I don't know, under oppression, you know, that what is going to become of us. But most of the people were what we call in France, or sans fou, or we call them je m'en foutistes, you know. They didn't care. They didn't care.
What had you heard was going on in Austria or Germany or in Poland about German treatment of Jews?
Interestingly enough, I don't remember even whether we heard something. I'm talking not till 1942, that period of time. I don't know how much we heard. I knew naturally before I left Vienna, I knew about Dachau already. I don't remember whether I knew about any other camps until later on, until 42 or later. I don't remember. You see, I was always ahead of the Germans. I never worried about the... I did worry, but we always had the initiative. We always were ahead of them, always a few steps ahead of them. And I don't remember being worried about being deported. It just didn't reach us. Our only object was to escape, to be caught. What would happen to us after we are caught? The thing we thought of, or we heard of, were the French camps, like Gurst, Drancy, Riefsalt, Vernet. There were camps in France which we were avoid to escape, and somehow it didn't worry us that much.
Had you heard any rumors of maltreatment, of mass shootings, executions?
In Germany or in the East or something? No. No, if I did, I forgot. I don't know. As I said, I was always ahead of it somehow, and I just didn't think of it. I just didn't think it could happen to me or to us, because, I think the many Jews who were caught in France, I'm talking about France only, I'm I know what was going on there. I lived there and I was very close to French people. I think many Jews could have survived. Many more Jews, now let's put it this way, many more Jews could have survived in France if they would have taken the initiative of surviving, of trying to survive. Some of them didn't survive because they were too complacent. They just sat there and waited what is going to happen. There were ways and means in France to survive, no question about it. The French people were good, they were bad ones, naturally. The French people basically were good, the French people were helpful. I had this experience myself, personally, and my wife had this experience, experience of my friends, and many, many of my friends survived. There's the famous example I mentioned to you, Jean-Bon Lignon, you know, there were ways and means to survive in France. Naturally, there were, then the Velodrome d'Hiver and all that, I know. I had family who was in Gurs, I know there were the other camps. And even so, it was family of mine, and I know how they were caught. The only reason they were caught is because they sat and waited.
Now, what happened in Lyon and after the Germans left? And
The Germans left, and I came then. I was back in Lyon. Naturally, I was looking for a job. One of the jobs I had, and immediately, jobs were hard to find. Naturally, because so many of the French people came from the north and were now in Vichy, France. They all looking for jobs. They had to live, and naturally, French people got jobs much easier and much better than we did. So I got a job as terrassier. That's somebody was digging earth, you know, I was digging a canal. And I worked especially with Spanish people, Republicans who came from Spain, refugees from Franco. A wonderful bunch of people, one of the nicest people I met in my life, I would say. Very warm, sincere, good-hearted, good-natured. I mostly worked with them. And I did that for quite a while, but it was hard work. I had never done work like that in my life. We built a canal near Saint-Genis-Laval, Saint-Fond, not too far from one of the big pharmaceutical companies south of Lyon. I forgot the name now. Anyhow, I worked there for a while, but being that it was hard work, and in order to get there, I had to ride the bicycle for about an hour. There was no good public transportation to get there, and it became really tough. So I left them there. And I went to Chambon sur Lignon. I was there then in a big youth camp by the Jewish Boy Scouts, Éclaireur Israël de France. And when we came back then from there, we talked about where should we go into the resistance, where should we hide, where would be the best place to survived the war. I have never thought of leaving France. And some of our leaders then said, for example, the Haute Loire is a very good place. Another good place would be, for example, in the south western part of France, Morsac, which became a very famous hideout for the Jewish youth leaders, Boy Scouts. And I decided just about, I'll probably go back to Chambon. Then again, I changed my mind and I stayed in Lyon. Couldn't find a job, went to the Veterans Administration, and they recommended me a job in a bar, restaurant, sur la place Bellecour in Lyon, which is called Moulin-Avant. And I started to work there. I told him I don't know anything about bartending. Don't worry about it, the boss will teach you.
Did they know you were Jewish?
The Veterans Administration? I don't think so, but they knew I was a foreigner, yes, because I had already an assumed name at that time. They sent me there, and my boss started to teach me how to mix drinks and all that. I was behind the bar after while a few days, I don't know, a week maybe, I became more relaxed and he let me approach the bar and already work at the bar. And there were some very well-dressed people, men, guests there, or civil, who were drinking and ordering and speaking French, but speaking German. And I was absolutely perplexed. I didn't expect it. So after a few days, I didn't dare saying anything. A few days, I walked over to my boss and said, "Who are these people there?" He says, "Don't you know?" I said, "No, I don't." He says, "That's the people from across the way, from the Hotel Royal, plus Bilkur, on the other side from the cafe house was the Hotel Royal corner." And that was the seat of the Gestapo. That's where the Gestapo lived. I said, "Ah." Now for a few days I didn't react. I didn't know what to do about it. First I wanted to be brave. Maybe I could help in some way working there. But then I figured I really don't have the experience to do that type of a job. And I said, "I better leave." I left then, and I still remember that they owe me. My salary for 3 days, for the first 3 days of the week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and a Wednesday night, I went home and I never came back. A while later then, the place was blown up by the resistance. Complete shambles. It was never rebuilt. It's now an agence, and the corner is like an excavation there, and it's a beautiful monument with the names of all the concentration camps engraved and superimposed on that. The name of the five hostages that Klaus Barbie had then brought on an open truck to the front of where the restaurant used to be. And as they descended off the truck, they were shut down and left in there for, I believe, a half a day or 24 hours on the sidewalk to scare the population of Lyon, to scare them and because of the, to show them that they shouldn't try to fight and undermine the German effort.
Do you know who any of those Gestapo people were?
No, I didn't know, but I found out later that Klaus Barbie was
one of your customers?
One of the customers, yes. I naturally didn't know him at that time. I found out the names of the five people who were killed, incidentally, they are superposed on the names of the concentration camps. It's a very, I would say it's a very moving monument, a soldier in front of the corner there with a shield, with the La Croix de Lorraine, sort of engraved in there. And then underneath the names, it says, "Passant va dire au monde qui sont morts pour la liberté," which I think is an absolute fantastic saying. You know, it's more than the names of the concentration camps and any name. I think the saying is the most important part of the monument. The most fantastic thing for me was when I came back for the first time to Lyon and looked at that monument. Actually, I didn't go to look for it the first time. I came to Lyon, believe it or not, the first time after the war. I did not look up any of my friends. I just walked the streets with my wife. Didn't look for anybody. I came to Lyon and I left Lyon without having called or found anybody. I haven't searched for anybody. That's the first time. I hadn't been back to Lyon for years afterwards. Next time when I came back, many years afterwards, then I looked up some people and then I looked also for the place where I worked and then I found the monument and I found the place, you know. It's funny that when I came back the first time, I wasn't even interested in my past. I was just looking at the city, the town. That's it, the streets.
Why do you think?
I don't know. I don't know. I was like in a fog when I came back the first time. I didn't, my best friend, I didn't even call him. I came back to Lyon in 1981, I believe, and I went to the hotel and I took out the phone book and I looked up a name, my friend's name. I found only one name, one person, one listing with his name, and I called up and I asked for him, and a lady answered the phone. I said, "He's not here. Are you his wife?" "Yes." And then I said, "I'm Max Kohler." In French it's pronounced Kohler. She, who never knew me, I had never met her because he got married way after I left, she answered back on the phone, "I knew it was you because Jean-Jacques expected your call for years." When I walked into a place in Chambon-sur-Lignon where I was looking for a young lady I knew there, and I traced her down finally, because the grocery store is now a supermarket. And I walked in there and I said, I would like to talk to Monsieur and Madame Nury. She said, oh, they're not here. I said, what do you mean they're not here? She said, they died, very hesitantly. I didn't remember how many children they had, and I was friendly with two of the children. I didn't know whether they were, I knew how many children, I knew there were three, but I didn't know how many boys and how many girls. I didn't remember that. Two and one, or one and, or two others of one, I just didn't remember. So I said, are you one of the daughters? So hesitantly again, she said, yes. I said, are you Jeanine Nury? She said, yes. I said, I'm Max Kohler. She held her hand over her mouth and said, oh my God, I thought you were dead. We are talking again 1981. From 45 to 81, I have not, did not make an attempt to find these people. What my feeling was afterwards, you can imagine when she said, you know, I still have your letters. We are talking about letters during the war, which I smuggled out of Switzerland. And so I said, what for? She said, oh, I kept them. I said, what did you do with them? I put them away with my mother's belongings. I said, when did your mother die? She tells her, she told me, I forgot now how many years ago she died. And she said, you know, mother talked about you till the day she died. She wondered whether you made it through the war. So you can imagine the way I felt. If there would have been a hole in the floor, I would have gone right through it. It was terrible. And these were people who were very nice and good to me. Now, why did I wait so long? I don't know. There are so many things about the war and about what we went through the war. Like, I'll give you another example. I had false papers. I had changed my name from, which were incidentally made in Chambon-sur-Lignon. I became, I mean, pro forma Protestant, and my name was Marcel Cornier. Now, the war was over. The day, or the next day, I don't know, the war was over. I threw away all my false documents. I have absolutely no proof. I have nothing not to prove to you that I was Marcel Cornier. How did I discover that? Very simple. A few years ago, I applied for Social Security, Secretary Social in France. And they asked me to prove to them from when to when I was where. So I had to prove to them that I was Marcel Cornier for a certain time. And I had no way of proving it, because I threw everything away. So I asked my wife, did you keep your papers? She said, no, I have nothing. We were so happy to regagner, to win back our identity, our own identity. We couldn't care less. We just threw it away. All right, I managed anyhow to prove it, and they believed me, you know. That's not the thing. But the interesting, I have nothing. I have absolutely nothing to prove them. I knew I got the papers in Chambon, because I knew. I didn't even know who gave me the papers. I remember I got them from the pastor of the Protestant church there. And interestingly enough, when I read the book, Lest Innocent Blood Be Shed, they're talking about Roger d'Arcissac in the book, who had all kind of stamps and papers and all the identity papers we got there, at least I got there, is we assumed a name, an existence of a person who had really lived, but had died already. So they were not completely falsified, only the dates were falsified. The person had really lived there. I never knew who made the paper. When I read the book, I saw that Roger d'Arcissac was instrumental in making papers there. So my goal was, I read the book and I had already planned a trip to Lyon. I was in France at the time. I said, all right, so we'll drive through Chambon-sur-Lignon to go to Lyon. And I went to visit Roger d'Arcissac. We got to the hotel and I called him. We have a common friend in Switzerland who had announced me already to Roger d'Arcissac. I called him from the hotel and the man said, oh, I invited him for dinner. I cannot come to your hotel because what you think, I'm an old man. I cannot walk downstairs. He lives in, I think, the only apartment building of Chambon-sur-Lignon on the third floor. I cannot come down, you come and see me, which we did. The other man was sitting in a tremendous size, big size living room, completely filled, stocked with pictures and books and albums and his TV set and his a table and a bureau and his easy chair. It was his living room and all his memorabilia. And there he sat and we had a wonderful talk. And when for a few hours, and when it was time to leave, he took us to the door, the apartment door, and he couldn't say goodbye. And he walked down with us one flight. He couldn't stop. He walked down a second flight. He still didn't stop. He walked down the door with us. Now, this is the man who didn't want to come to the hotel, and suddenly he was down the street with us. He walked a few steps down the street just to show me the door. Do you remember Le Presbytère? That's where the That was the house, it's the parsonage of the church, the Temple Protestant, you know, to show me that which I naturally remembered. But he was so moved by it. The most beautiful thing of our meeting was, naturally he didn't remember whether he made my paper or not. He made so many papers, how could he remember? But the most moving part of the meeting was that a few months later he died, and both his children knew about me by then already. Both his children had sent me an announcement of his death, and one didn't know from the other that I was that they were in touch with me. And I'm really glad that I went to see him before that, because it was I think I owed it to him and to myself and to all the other people he helped, really, to go there and thank him.
What was your role in the story of the Chambon?
In the story, no role at all. No, we were there to build a sort of a nucleus of resistance. I had a very bad accident right at the beginning, a bicycle accident. That there was no penicillin at that time. I was treated by a doctor as well as he could treat me. But the infection spread. I had an open knee, and infection spread terribly that they just couldn't keep me there anymore, and they had to send me down to Lyon, to a hospital, St. Francis of Assisi in Lyon, where I had to be operated immediately. Matter of fact, in the middle of the night, they operated on me because it was almost too late. I almost lost the leg. It was the beginning of the of a resistance nucleus in Chambon. Most of my friends stayed there. Some of them came then all the time, being that I was safe in the hospital in Lyon, my hospital room, and later on the room in the convalescent home, which belonged to the hospital, became sort of our office then, you know, where we had papers, printed papers, distributed papers from. It was a safe place because it was midst of a Catholic neighbor church, you know. I was pretty safe there, and we were pretty safe there, until I sort of smelled some danger, and then I said, enough is enough, and I could walk then already, barely, but I could walk with two canes. And we organized my transport in an ambulance into Switzerland. I took the train first. I don't remember to the town. I believe it was Salange in the Savoie, you know, Swiss border. And from there, an ambulance was waiting for me there, and my parents were with me. I sat in the ambulance. My parents sat with me in the back of the ambulance. An attendant was in the back with us, and an attendant in the front with the driver. And the ambulance then traveled over a country road into no man's land. Now the chance we had to take was leaving France, and on the French border there were always one Frenchman and one German guards at that time already. So we were stopped at the border, and that's the 50-50 chance we had to take. Now they asked us what we were doing, opened the door, and the ambulance driver and the attendant said it's an emergency appendectomy, and to had to bring me to a hospital. I forgot the town now. In order to go from that one town to the next town, you had to go to no man's land. Not into Switzerland, but no man's land and come back into France. So we took the chance there, and they said, it's all right, and closed the door. And we traveled We traveled then a few kilometers into no man's land, and then they opened the door and I walked out of the ambulance with my parents and walked into Switzerland, knowing very well that the border wasn't closed yet. They still accepted refugees in Switzerland. It was closed a few weeks later, I don't remember. We walked into Switzerland, and after a kilometer or so, the Swiss border guard caught us already and took us into the Stade de Varambe in Geneva, and which was a sort of distribution camp, and from there into what is called in was called in Switzerland at that time an Auffangslager, a camp where they caught the refugees. We were in that camp for a few weeks, and then people were sent into Arbeitslager, into working camps, where we did some work. Nothing, no comparison naturally with concentration camps or anything like that. After 6 weeks, you had a 3-day pass to go on a vacation or wherever you wanted to go see your family, and you got reduced rate on the railroad then for this vacation. It was a camp, your liberty was, your freedom was confined, but still it was very humane.
When was this?
That was January 1943, February, January, February 1943. Mm-hmm. And I was in there again. My experience of having worked as a terrassier in France was very helpful, and I made career very fast. I became what is called a Gruppenführer, which means a foreman, and had really basically a good time. We formed immediately a soccer team again there in Switzerland, which was called the soccer team of the interned people, the internees, and we played against teams in Switzerland. We had basically a good time there, because you have to remember that between 42 and 45, Switzerland didn't have any tourists. So we were the tourists whenever we were permitted to go somewhere. So it was all right. We were confined. Naturally, the danger of being surrounded by Germany was always there. Swiss neutrality was extremely strict, because the Swiss always had to be nice to Germany, because they were afraid to be invaded eventually, naturally, which I don't think would have ever happened, because there was so much German money hidden away in Switzerland. Why would they invade their own money, you know? They had it in safe places, you know? But anyhow, Swiss played the neutrality to an extreme, really, to favor Germany, mm-hmm. until when they saw that Germany was losing the war, then that neutrality switched the other way, you know?
Did your fellow internees, did they know that you also were a Jewish?
In Switzerland?
Fugitive?
Oh yeah, they knew exactly. Oh yes, you didn't fool anybody there, you couldn't, because you were worried that if find something wrong with you, the ship you right back. Mm-hmm. Sure, no, you wouldn't have. Swiss was, and I think in many ways is still a police state. You don't fool around there.
Mm-hmm. Did you return to France?
From Switzerland, I was brought back by a special decree of the French government. I was back on the first transport, because they wanted me back. A decree, I believe it was General Philippe König, if the name is correct. I have the papers on that. 10 people were brought back from Switzerland to France before anybody else, and I was one of the 10. They wanted me back to reorganize in the youth movements and a big camp in France, in the southwest of Lyon. So I was 1 day in Lyon. We're back from Switzerland. I was 1 or 2 days in Lyon, and I was up already. Up there and worked on again in the youth movements. I came back, and I was never really in the business world. My life and my dream was youth. Mm. All my friends were in there, and I left it there, and I came right back to it like I wasn't even away, you know. I had been in contact while I was in Switzerland. I had been in contact with Lyon and all my friends there, so I stepped right back into what I practically left yesterday, sort of.
Now, you said you helped to begin a core of the resistance movement. Mm-hmm. What did that involve when you went to Chambord, near Chambord?
What we wanted to do was it's an industrial region there. It's not too far from Saint-Étienne. There were munition factories there, and I believe motorcycles they made there, or bicycles and things like that. And naturally, Saint-Étienne was the region of coal mines. And what we were trying to do is interrupt the ligne ferroviaire, the railroad lines between there and what Germany was trying to pull out of there.
So it was industrial sabotage. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. We were not really armed or anything. You know, we were a bunch of kids. A bunch of kids with great ideals and dreams. You know. The real resistance, I mean, in near Lyon, the real resistance was really in the work corps near Grenoble.
Was there a connection with the
resistance? No. Our connection was strictly through the Écrivains Élites de France. That was our connection. Basically with the people who the book is written about, Lestiniers and Plattbichette, we had nothing to do with them, really. But we were in the region because the region was so strongly against Germany, and the region was so strongly religious, and the people were so good to us and to everybody because of their strong religious background, that we thought it was the perfect place to be if we wanted to survive and be in a small way constructive.
Do you remember any specific incidents when you were helped by French non-Jews?
Yes, I would say the most significant was when I came back from the hospital. Actually, I just couldn't stand anymore after my operation. I was 6 weeks in the hospital and I wanted to go home. I just couldn't stand it anymore because I was confined in that hospital, you know. No way to move. So the surgeon said, but you're out of your mind. Why would you do that? You're in danger the moment you get out of here. Stay here. No, I didn't want to. Okay, so I went home. And I don't think I was home more than 2 hours. The French police came to warn me that within 2 hours they'll come back with the Gestapo to pick me up. So what did I do? I just called back the hospital, asked to speak to the surgeon, and you can guess his answer. He said, didn't I tell you so? Went right back to the hospital. And the French police with the Gestapo came then and sealed the apartment. They put like a seal over the door and the door frame. And everything was in there. My parents came with me to the hospital. And everything was left in the apartment, actually. I mean, it wasn't our furniture, it was a furnished apartment, but still we had clothing and jewelry, whatever we had, I don't remember. So we had a friend in Lyon who was a more or less collaborator. She was German, non-Jewish. Her husband was French. He was one of the silk manufacturers. Lyon was the center of the silk industry in France. And they believed in Germany. They thought that the best thing that could happen to France was Germany. And Germany is going to clean up France. And Germany is going to do, going to make out of France a strong and powerful state. And she went out with people from the SS and from the Wehrmacht, and they were friends, and they came to dinner to her house, and she went to the commander too, and all that. And we were her friends, and she knew we were Jewish. We were friends for a long time. They believed in Germany. That's all. And then when we called her, and she said, don't you worry about it. And she went right to the apartment. She broke the seal. She couldn't care less. Broke the seal, took out whatever we wanted, took it to her house, took my parents eventually to her house. They stayed there for a few days. She was hiding them. Another example. But now, I'm talking now not only of non-Jewish French people. I'm talking of non-Jewish French people who were sympathizers of Germany.
Did you ever speak to her? Were there ever political discussions with this woman? Or?
Not that I remember. I never stayed there. I knew her, naturally, and we were friends. My parents were friends with them. No, I never saw her. I never saw her again since then, no. Because I don't even know what happened to her, to tell you the truth, because I didn't go back there. No, no idea. No idea what happened to her. I know she survived the war. Whether she was caught after the liberation and treated as a collaborator, and I don't know, I never tried to find out. There were other instances, like a family who took my wife in. My wife lived in Grenoble at that time and survived the war, a family had taken her in and protected her all the way through. She was taken in sort of as a bond, as a household, working in the household, you know. Mm-hmm. And she survived the war fully, you know, and I have many friends who survived the war too, just by the goodness or kindness or decency of French people.
Were they endangering themselves by helping you?
Yes, definitely. Definitely, I know cases where people received mail for other people and transmitted mail for other people, and they were definitely in danger.
Do you remember the Nacht und Nebel decree? 9 and 5 decree?
No.
I'm just curious, in 1941 and 42.
Where was that?
This is in France, but it was passed by the Vichy government.
No. What is it called in France? In French?
9 and 5.
Nuit et Brouillard is Night and Fog.
There's a famous film named Night and Fog, which takes the name from it.
No,
but they were then...
Never heard of it.
Yeah. They were then given a license to arrest people in the middle of the night and hold them without any reason as a police decree. I thought that may have been something that...
I don't remember it. I never heard of it. Maybe I heard of it and forgot. I don't know. I don't remember it.
But when in 1943, when you were back in Lyon.
No, 1943. I wasn't anymore in Lyon. That was already in France. I'm sorry. I was in Switzerland already. 1943.
But you returned from Switzerland to.
No, I returned to Switzerland in 1944.
Then what, back to Lyon again.
Back to Lyon.
Then
to the Haute Loire.
Again with the youth movement.
With the youth movement.
What were you doing?
Then that's what I said before, with the reorganization of the youth movement, that there were a lot of kids who had lost their parents, who didn't know where the parents were, separated from their parents and all that. And we regrouped approximately 4,500 kids then.
Now, did this continue then to the end of the war?
That continued way after the end of the war, way after. That continued till approximately, I would say 46, at least 46, 46, yeah, 45, 46. And then there was a lapse between that, and in between I went to work in 47, I believe. Yes, it must have been 47. I got married in June. I must have started beginning 47. I started to work for the Jewish agency in Lyon first. And when they saw that they had somebody they could use, you know. They hired me sort of on recommendation by the director of the youth movement, the Fédération Société Juive de France, it was called. When they saw that I could be very useful to them, they asked me whether I would move to Marseille, from Lyon to Marseille, because the job in Lyon was secondary, really. Whether I would move to Marseille to take on a much bigger job, and the salaries we were paid were absolutely fantastic for France at that time, because the salaries were really salaries in dollars. Mm-hmm. But most of the money came from the American Joint Distribution Committee. So these salaries were so fantastic, translated into French francs, that I couldn't resist. And this was the basis on what we got married eventually, because it was a fantastic situation, really. And I moved into Marseille and worked for the Jewish agency in Marseille.
Before you tell me about that, excuse me, do you remember any of the anti-Jewish legislation that was passed after the German occupation? And
in
Vichy
France, yeah. What was his name? The man who survived the whole thing and just died recently in Spain, I forgot the name. Yes, they were all. I know. I don't remember distinctly what the anti-Jewish legislations were. I know there were some, but there again, I don't remember it. It's funny. It's interesting that you asked me that. I was never worried about it.
You never
I
felt
just,
that.
No. I never felt threatened about it. This is the interesting, and that's probably why I don't remember it. I give you my word. I'm not trying to block it out of my mind. I don't remember it. And you know when I remember it? When I read it in books. I have some books here, very interesting books, like Soldiers of the Night by David Schönborn, for example. I have some other books by, I just bought it recently. I saw it advertised in, I think, the Hadassah magazine. I can give you the titles, I don't remember now. But in there, when I read these books, first I find all the names of all the people I worked with or for, names which have evaded me. And then I read about these legislations which came up. And when I read about it, I remember it.
So but your father was never affected by that?
No.
Any legislation either?
No. He worked for a dentist who was very close to the Cardinal Gerlier of Lyon, incidentally, one of the great controversial, so they say, figures. All I know is only about the good things he did. He did a fantastic job for the Jews of Lyon. And I think it was one of the very few people I know that the Germans were afraid of, sort of. Very powerful man, very strong man. And then some other people say that he that he didn't do enough. Let's put it this way, didn't do enough for the Jews. But then again, you have to realize a situation where who can decide whether you did enough and who can decide when to stop, because if you do a little more, whatever you do might become ineffective. It's the story with the Pope, you know, Pacelli, but I think it was Pius the 12th, mm-hmm. History says that maybe he didn't do enough, maybe he didn't fight the Germans enough, maybe he didn't resist enough. If he would have, how do you know that he could have been as effective as he was in a small way now? It's very hard. And the same thing they're saying about Gerlier. So my father worked for a dentist who was a friend of Cardinal Gerlier and completely protected. That dentist let him run the whole office there. My father had no certificate to be a chirurgeon dentist, a surgeon dentist. My father's boss was there where the days he wasn't even there. My father did the whole thing and the French police couldn't care less.
So your parents also survived the war?
Oh, survived the war and weren't really in any more danger than I was. And they were with me all the time. The only time we were separated is when I was brought back from Switzerland. And they had to stay long in Switzerland because they weren't repatriated like I was for emergency. It wasn't really an emergency. I believe that I was brought back because my friends who had remained in France urged the government, hey, get him back. I'm sure. I can see, because that important a job, it wasn't that important a job. I had probably somebody, and I could never find out. I tried, I could never find out. Somebody must have pushed a button to get me back faster, that's all.
Tell me a little bit about your work in Marseille.
In Marseille, when I moved to Marseille and I worked for the Jewish agency in Marseille, I was one of the very few people from France who worked for the agency. The others were what we called the shilichim, that came from Israel to help us out, really. They helped us all right, but it was more the job they had to do was more a preparation of the people we had from the DP camps to prepare them for their life in Israel. Organization-wise or preparatory for the departure, for the emigration to Israel, we did all the work. They did I would hate to use that word, but I think the best word really would be indoctrination of the people to get them ready for Israel. So I was one of the very few people, French people, I wasn't French, but I mean people from France who were doing the work there. And my job was I didn't have an official title like the transport manager of the Jewish agency. So the important things I had to do, I was told there will be a boat there and there, and the boat has room for so and so many people, and you have to bring them there, night or day or whatever. whatever we did there was naturally illegal, officially illegal, but the French government knew about it. And there again is proof that the French people or the French government wasn't that bad, because nobody will ever make me believe that the French government in Marseille, the prefecture, the Bouches-du-Rhône, for example, or the police didn't know what we were doing. Because when you have camps with 4,000 to 5,000 people on a steady basis in these camps around Marseille, don't tell me. Beside the point when we didn't get enough food from the United States, again from the American joint or whoever sent us food, I went to the prefecture to get the coupon de ravitaillement, the food ration coupons. And they didn't, there was no way for me to prove to them how many people were in the camp. They asked me, Max, how many are there? I told him how many are there, I got the coupons. Mm-hmm. So that was, you cannot have more cooperation than that. Or when we run trucks to certain ports like Bandol or La Ciotat and Cassis, I don't think we used, Saint-Maxime, Saint-Tropez, you know, when we ran the trucks during the night with people, get them out of the trucks, put them on a small boat, row them out to the fishing boat which was waiting outside, don't tell me nobody knew.
Any big boats?
The big boat, now the biggest naturally was the Exodus, mm-hmm. That was the big job, and that's the one I...
You were instrumental in that?
Yeah, I had to bring the people to the... to Set. The Exodus left from the harbor of Set, S-E-T-E, which is about halfway between Marseille and the Spanish border, big fishing port. And that naturally was a big job, because that was 4,500 people. And prove the point, I always say that at the beginning of the Declaration of Independence should have been written with the day of the Exodus, because when that Exodus ran out, got caught and brought back, and on three Liberty ships, they had to split them up, then 1,500 apiece, and came back then to Port-au-Bouc near Marseille. That whole history of the Exodus, departure, brought back, refused, sent back to Hamburg, then came, and when they came back by train then to Marseille, I mean, that for me, that was the beginning of the independence of Israel, of the creation of Israel, because the world knew at that time that there is a problem and we have to solve the problem, we have to know what to do with these people, and sooner or later we have to stop smuggling them into Palestine, and I would say that for me that was it.
Why were they refused re-entry into Marseille?
We told the French government not to let them in, not to accept them. The French government would have taken them in. They would have done whatever we wanted to.
Why?
Because they were nice to us.
But why?
Because
what
we wanted
to leave them
with the British people, with the British government, to leave them on their hands. They didn't know what to do with them. They tried to peddle them all over the world. And I'm sure that some countries would have accepted them if the Jewish agency would have asked them to. But nobody did, and so they finally brought him back to Hamburg, which was then the capital of the British occupied zone of Germany. And then they were right back on the train. I think within a week or so, the first ones came back to Marseille. And then soon we put them on small boats again, and they went through again. Some of them got caught, but most of them went through. And but that, for me, that was it. From then on, the whole thing became so relaxed somehow that it came to a point where that's when I then started to think of leaving the agency. It became like a travel agency. The fun was gone. It became like, you know, then we got closer and closer to Marseille then to ship them out, you know. And then towards the end, then we shipped them, they left from Marseille. From the harbor of Marseille, like a cruise ship, you know. So now that was no more fun. I mean, that was an automatic thing, you know. There was no more challenge in it, you know. Not that there was a danger before, but still there was the challenge. You had to do it during the night, and you had to row him down out to the boat, you know. You had to find a port which would be effective or which would be suitable for the operation and all that. But then it was in the harbor of Marseille. That was no more fun. In 51, I then went to Israel for 3 months because I wanted to prepare the emigration of our whole family to Israel. That was the end with my work for the agency, and came back then, and we decided then to come to the United States, which we did then at the end of 51. I'm talking about, I was in Israel in for 3 months, in February, March, April 51, that's right, and we came to the United States, and in December 51, I came back from Israel, and we decided then to immigrate to the United States.
Let me, because it's late, and let me jump ahead. Do you talk about the experiences during the war with many people?
Yes, I never did in New York. Or again, I don't know. I never talked to anybody about it. The only time the whole thing really came up was I went to the Jewish center in Merrick, where I lived, for a talk by a man, his name is Reverend Graubel, I believe was the name, and he was a member of the crew of the Exodus.
Hmm.
And after the talk, I went up to him and asked him, and introduced myself, and he was completely stunned. Naturally, he didn't know me, I didn't know him, because I didn't know anybody in Exodus. I saw the boat for the first time at 4 or 4:30 in the morning when daylight was coming up. That's when I saw the boat. Mm-hmm. And everybody was on the boat already. We just came to the boat then and said goodbye, and that was the end of the story. So, and he asked me what I was doing here, and then naturally he questioned me immediately about some people, because he thought maybe I was faking it or whatever, you know. He didn't trust me like mm-hmm. I didn't trust him in a way, you know. So he asked me about certain people, and I told him, gave him answers, and I told him exactly who worked for the Mossad and all that, you know. He was so completely stunned, and he didn't know what to say. And then he said, what I was doing in Merrick. I said, well, what do you mean what I'm doing in Merrick? What are you doing here? And then we started to talk about the Exodus. Another time I talked to somebody, I had a tag sale here on my parking lot here for old things I was selling, and then somebody came from a camp not too far away from here, and a man with the two youngsters, and the two youngsters spoke Ivrit. And I told him, you're speaking Ivrit. He said, how do you know? I said, I happen to know Ivrit, not that I speak it, but I happen to know it. He said, how come? So I told him who I was, and how come I know it. And he says, if I remember correctly, either captain or second captain. My father was captain or second captain of the Exodus. And this was a youngster who worked here in the Camp Shalom, which doesn't exist anymore in the area. I think it was in Beckett or somewhere around here. But I never spoke about it until, really, I came to the high school here. When I moved to Lenox, I started to teach at the high school. And it was a very funny experience, because they really didn't know what a Jew was when I came here. And then later on in years, then we had the movie, the educational movie on the Holocaust. And the social studies teacher remembered that I'm coming from the old country, like they say. So he invited me to come, and they made they wanted to have a question and answer period, just one period after the film. Out of that one period became 2 solid days. I couldn't do my own teaching. I had to sit in the social studies classes who had seen the film, and the question and answers were going for 2 solid days. It was quite interesting, because you talked to children who didn't even know what a Jew was, who did, much less the Holocaust. A typical question was, Mr. Kowler, tell me, under the camps in Germany, under concentration camps, these tunnels, were they really like that? That you could run in and out of the tunnel, out of the camp? You know what they compared the camps to? Hogan's Heroes on TV. I was the curious animal. I was like a curious animal in the zoo, you know? I felt like I was in a cage, and they all looked at me because they hadn't seen an animal like that before. I think I brought some enlightenment to that school, because they didn't know what it was. And I think it was a fantastic experience for them and for me. A typical question of a student, for example, not a typical, I shouldn't say that, an interesting question of a student, for example, was, whenever I talked to them about it, naturally I made it clear that I was never in a concentration camp, But I told him that in a way I'm prejudiced against Germany because I will never forget what Germany brought on us, you know. And that I apologized that, you know, if sometimes maybe I'm prejudiced and I can't stay neutral, you know. Please forgive me, etc. So one girl raised her hand and said, "Mr. Kowler, it's funny. You seem to really to hate what came out of Germany, what happened to you. So how come you teach German?" Well, my answer then was that German, after all, is my mother tongue. I grew up with it, and I can never deny it. And there is no reason why I should hate the German language, because it is my language. Another absolutely fantastic experience. I was invited then by other social studies teachers in different schools in the area here, and one day I came to Mount Greylock Regional High School, and we talked again about the Holocaust, the past, my past, other people like ours past, you know. And the class was, it was a selected class really, and the kids, before I said goodbye to them, I thanked them for having been as attentive as they were, and I had to thank them, I had a good time, etc. And then I said, "I hope you got, I believe I said 75 or 80% of what I said, that you understood, that you caught the meaning of what I've been trying to tell you, what happened in the world, what happened to us Jews, what happened to refugees in Europe." And there, a young lady in the corner of the room raises her hand and asks her what she wanted to say. She said, "Mr. Kowler, what makes you believe that we understood only 75 or 80%? "Mr. Kowler, I know exactly what you said because my grandparents always told me about the lynchings in the South." She compared what happened to us. She was black. She compared what happened to us to the lynchings in the South. When I left that school, believe me, I knew every mile I traveled to go to that school, it's about an hour's drive from here, was worth it. It's good to, I don't like to dwell on our past, but it's good to talk about it. Now, recently I was invited to talk about the book, Lest Innocent Blood Be Shed. It was read, I interested them in the book. They found out, some people bought the book, and then they formed sort of like a social book club or something like that in two churches here. Each of the church invited me once to come to a discussion about the book. In one church it became 3 nights, the other church became 2 nights. Non-ending radio station invited me, for example, 2 radio stations, one of them on a call-in show that I was on the show. People were permitted to call in and ask questions which I had to answer immediately, which is really tough. It's easy to answer when you sit somebody face to face and you can either evade a direct answer or think about the answer you want to give or correct your answer. On the radio you clearly can't. I was a little uncomfortable at the beginning, but it worked out all right. The man who ran that show, who owns that show, was pretty good to put me at ease. One night I had after the show I had a very nasty phone call. Somebody called me and really gave me said some dirty names to me, called me some dirty names, not threatening, but dirty names, which on the first call I didn't understand, and then he called me back 5 minutes later, same voice again. I recognized the voice, not that I know the voice, but I recognized it was the same voice, and called me the same thing again, and then I knew that I understood well the first time. Some anti-Semitic call. Another time there was an article in the paper by a former senator, I believe, of New York State, in a Springfield paper, and I wrote then to the Springfield paper, the Springfield Union, and they called me and said, "You must know much more about it." It was about the Klaus Barbie thing. "You must know much more about it than you let on." I said, "Yes, I do, but you know, I know that the letters to the editor are always shortened, you know, always edited, so I didn't write the whole thing. So they sent a reporter here, interviewed me, and then the local paper did the same thing. I almost had a big spread in the paper with pictures and all that about my life and what I knew about Klaus Barbie. And then I was very proud of Springfield Union. I wanted really to put me parallel with William Shira, who lives in our town here. But they couldn't reach William Shira because he has an unlisted phone number and he wasn't home. So what they did then, instead of putting me side by side with him, they had an article by William Shira a couple of days later, and many of the things he said about the same subject were really in agreement with what I said. Only what he said it in nicer and better words because his English is a little better than mine, and he said it also in stronger words because he doesn't have to worry about it. He gave some opinion about our generals and the American generals compared to the French generals, which were really surprising. He was talking about what our government really did to cover up the Klaus Barbie case, you know, and how our army really messed up the thing in putting him to work, even so they knew he was a war criminal, you know, and compared our generals to the French generals, for example, and said that our generals cannot even hold a candle to the French generals, you know, in education, etc., you know. I wouldn't have dared to say that, but Bill Shira is Bill Shira.
But do you think that you've begun to talk more about it in the recent past than not?
Yeah. Oh, no, I never, you know, I never, I don't know why, but not that I tried to avoid it or tried to hide it or was afraid of. No, I just didn't. It never came to my mind.
Are there things that remind you about it on a sort of daily routine basis? Something
of my past?
Touch up on memory?
No, it's just, I don't think I had forgotten anything. I just forgot about the whole thing for a while, I guess. And then, you know, we have many of my guests are psychiatrists, and they tell me that I guess you weren't ready for it, whatever that means. I don't know, maybe I wasn't ready for it, if that's what it is. I mean, I don't know. I don't know much about psychiatry or psychology, but I just didn't talk about it. I just neglected the whole thing. It just, not that I was worried about it, not that I tried to push it away from me, not that I avoided the subject. It just exists until one day. And I really think that I rediscovered that particular part of the past with the book Lest Innocent Blood Be Shed. If I wouldn't have found that article on a mantelpiece at the Jewish Community Center in Pittsfield, I have the clipping, I cut out that clipping from that newspaper from Albany that the town of Chambon-sur-Lignon was given an honorary degree in law by Haverford University. Haverford, yeah, it's near Philadelphia, no? And that the town was given that award. And because of because the university became aware of it, because of the Lest Innocent Blood Be Shed, and I just didn't believe my eyes. And then it was just before the season. I didn't have time. I would have gone there for the award because Madame Trocmé was there. I would have loved to go there. But I didn't have time anymore. I had to prepare the season here. And then one day, I said, after the season, I'll have more time. I get the book and all that. And then one day, a guest of mine came the first, second week of the season, and she's unpacked, and then she sat on the porch. She's coming this weekend, incidentally, that same guest, it's funny, yeah. She sat on the front porch there and opened the book, and I walked over to her, Judy, what are you reading? And she opened the book and said, Lest Innocent Blood Be Shed. Do you know about it? I said, do I know about it? And she opens the book, and I see the picture, and I said, that's the house where I stayed, etc., you know. So anyhow, I said, Judy, when you're finished, let me read it. I'll send it back to you. And she said, why? I told her why. Then she says, Max, I'll finish it while I'm here. She was staying a week. I'll finish while I'm here, and then I offer you the book. It's a present. And that is my book now. That's the book I'm using, you know. And I think that started the whole thing. That started the whole thing, that I remembered that I had the desire to go back to Chambon-sur-Lignon, that I went out of my way to go back to Chambon-sur-Lignon, that I talked about it. And the Klaus Barbie thing, I guess, too, was instrumental. I wrote to the man who is the mayor of that small town where where Jean Moulin, that's the famous French resistance leader, got caught. I wrote to him that that was one of the big things of Klaus Barbie. He caught Jean Moulin and then he practically killed him. He killed him. I mean, he didn't die in his hands, he died on the way. I wrote to the mayor and I offered him my help if I can be of any help. And believe it or not, I didn't even get an answer. The big question is now, I'm in touch naturally with my friends in Lyon, whether that trial is ever going to come up. The trial was supposed to start last January now. Mm-hmm. Last January was a year that he was brought back, and they said it'll be a year till they're ready for the trial, and there's still nothing. One of the big men behind the trial, sort of pushing it, is the president du consistoire in Lyon, who used to be a Cub Scout under me at the Jewish Boy Scouts. I saw him when I was in Lyon. I should correct myself. I don't know whether he's pushing, and he might not be pushing it. It's very funny. Some of the people in Lyon don't, even Jews, don't want to try it. They're afraid it might recreate waves of anti-Semitism, or create waves of anti-Semitism, or make stronger waves of anti-Semitism. It's an interesting situation because you don't even know how many French people want it or don't want it. I believe very strongly that the youth of France wants it because they want to know what happened during the war and why it happened during the war. And there are a lot of French people actually don't want it because he might spill the beans and say who collaborated or didn't. I think that's his strength. And I'm only afraid they're going to let him sit and die in prison without a trial. And I think that wouldn't be fair. No reason why they should let that happen.
You think it wouldn't be fair to young people in France?
Yeah. I think history should be told, the story should be told, history should be taught, and I don't think it would be fair to let him sit there and die without bringing the whole thing into the open. I was 100% sure he'll come to a trial as time goes on now, and what I hear from my friends from Lyon, I begin to wonder. It is so quiet about the whole thing that I just wonder whether they're going to bring him out to trial now. And I think it's just not right. It's no right. But then again, you know, I spoke to people here about it, and I remember one of the ladies asked me that. I spoke at the Women's Club of Pittsfield, in a hushed audience. And a lady asked me whether it's really worth it after so many years to bring the man to trial. I said, how can you say that? And the best example I gave her then, I said, do you think, I think the figure is 14,000 people, he killed or was instrumental in the death of 14,000 people, do you think 14,000 people aren't important enough to bring it to a trial? We are not talking about a bicycle thief. I use that, you know. Bicycle thief, if you did that 30, 40 years ago, all right, forget it. 40,000 people. And you just can't let it go by. I mean, as time goes by, people have a tendency of trying to forget, wanting to forget. Why should we? Stir up muddy waters, and unfortunately many French Jews feel that way too. They want to sit back and let's forget it, let's not have anti-Semitism, let's not grow more anti-Semitism that we already have. And it is absolutely amazing when I come back to France how my friends are worried about anti-Semitism in France. It is unbelievable. I think in the worst of my times in Austria, I never heard so much about anti-Semitism as I hear now when I come to France. The people are so worried about it. And I can't understand it. I listen to it, I believe them, but I just can't understand it. It's interesting. All these, the attentats which they had in Paris, you know, at the Jewish restaurant and all that, the French people are so worried about, the French Jews are so worried about anti-Semitism, it's absolutely unbelievable.
Well, I hope you keep on teaching and enlightening people in this area.
I hope so. I hope they listen to me. I certainly will go.